some reminder of what we talked about toward the end of last class. In the fraction 5/7, first of all, which is the denominator?
7
is the denominator. And the numerator is? 5/7, numerator, denominator. So the number in the denominator, we talked about it last time, what does it mean? Charlie?
How many make a whole?
How many make a whole? Say that?
The whole number was broken up into 7 pieces.
Whole number was broken into 7 pieces. Okay. Sean?
The size of pieces split into one whole.
Okay. So like, just the size of the pieces, it's quick, it's short, reminds us what it's all about. Okay. Both of these are great. This is even more of a complete answer than this is. It's great. It's just this is a little bit shorter and I think reminds us pretty well. And the numerator, what does it tell us? Something new today? Alex?
The number that makes up the pieces.
The number that makes up the pieces. What do you mean by that?
Well, that's the number of how many pieces can fit.
From what you're saying, it sounds a little bit more like that's what the denominator is saying, like that's how many pieces can fit in the whole thing.
Oh.
Right? How about 5, please?
It's how many pieces there are.
How many there are, okay. How about how many you have?
Yeah.
Okay. Because you could almost say this is how many pieces there are as well. Okay. So out of a possible 7 in the whole thing, you have 5 of those pieces, right? Okay. Can somebody again come up and show us 5/7 with this line down here? Somebody new? Blake? Blake's going to help us out. See, what does everybody think?
Good.
Good, yeah. 7 pieces total, this whole thing. The whole could be anything. In this case, it's a line segment, and we're cutting it into 7 pieces. And by shading them in, we're saying that we have 5 of those pieces. Okay? So far, so good? We're going to look at multiplication of these fractions, but where I said we would pick it up from last time. First, the thing I'm going to show you here is going to be on the next screen, is going to be a square. I'm going to remind you about this square. The square here is, this line, just like this line, is one whole line, okay? You represent one anything. This other one is also going to be one whole line. And so the area of that is what?
One.
Right? You can imagine with fractions, if we're talking about fractions that are less than 1, okay, makes it kind of easy to talk about in that way. Fractions, these numbers that are less than 1, the number that we get when we multiply them together probably be less than 1, right?
Right.
We're taking a number that's less than 1, and we're taking some of that number that's less than 1, so naturally this number that we get is going to be less than 1, right?
Right.
If I take 6/7 and 4/5, right? 6/7 times 4/5, so that just means like 4/5 of 6/7, which 6/7 is already less than 1. I'm going to take even a smaller piece of it, so it's going to be even less than that was of 1, okay? All right, so this next thing we're going to see, it's going to be a square that's 1 by 1, but we're going to take a couple of fractions, we're going to multiply them together. Remember how we can see multiplication by area? If you look at the area of something,
yeah.
Okay, we're going to look at these two fractions, you're going to make a rectangle, the area of that rectangle will be product of those two numbers. Okay? You ready for that? Here we go. So this is just exactly what we have from the end of last class. 4/5, okay, you can see it's 4/5 because we cut it into 5 pieces along this one side, and we will concentrate on 4 of them, okay, like Blake just did with 5/7. And along here, 3/8, you can see the little bracket around 3 of these 8 pieces. Right. So right in here, what do we see? In simplest, broadest terms, what will the area of this rectangle be? Sean?
It will be...
Not a number, I don't want a number.
Oh.
What will it represent? The number, whatever it is that we find, what will it represent? Yeah?
4/5 times
3/8. Great, 4/5 times 3/8, okay? And the great thing about what we're about to do is we're going to see why we multiply fractions the way that we do, because really we're just trying to figure out how many pieces make the whole and how many pieces of those do we have. That's it. That's what fractions are. Okay. So let's first talk about how many pieces we have. Okay. So along this way we have 4 of the 5 pieces. Here we have 3 of the 8 pieces. When I take 4 pieces by 3 pieces, how many pieces are there?
12.
Right in here, there are 12 pieces. Now, these pieces, they're weird. They're not squares, right?
Right.
Not like the area usually is. So we can't just say, oh, we have 12 squares. The area, that's not going to be 12, right? That'd be pretty big. What's the area of this whole square? Remember, it's a 1 by 1 square? So how big is the area of that square? 1. Remember, area is how many squares fit? How many squares fit in a 1 by 1 square? 1 square. So here we have 12 pieces. That's how many we have. 12, right? We have that many. So in a fraction, which number is the number that you, of how many you have?
On top.
Numerator. Right? We'll use fancy math language. Numerator. Okay. Well, 4 times 3 tells us how many pieces we have. Now to figure out what those pieces are, because they're not squares like area usually is. What are those pieces? Well, they are these pieces that are part of a whole, right? And to tell you what they are, just like I'm telling you these are fifths and these are eighths, and in the previous screen they were sevenths. What are these pieces? How many of them does it take to make the whole square? 40? Okay. In the picture, how do you figure out that there's 40 pieces that make up the whole? Cadence?
5 times 8.
There are 5 that make up this one thing, and 8 that make up this one thing. 5 times 8? 40 of those things. Size of pieces. Does that make sense? You see the fraction multiplication there? That's straight across multiplication. When I learned multiplication of fractions, I thought, how nice. That's very convenient. I don't have to find common denominators. I don't have to do cross multiplying. I don't have to do anything weird. I just multiply the top numbers together and the bottom numbers together, right? And I never knew why. This picture is picture of why, right? Alex, you have something?
No, you answered it.
Okay.
So wouldn't you have to simplify that?
Yeah, we should simplify this. Okay. So, Grady, how do we simplify a fraction like 12/40?
We could do divide by 4.
Divide this guy by 4 like that. You didn't even stop at 2. This makes it look confusing. Hold on. Divide by 4. We both have a divisor in 4, a 4 in common. Okay? So we get 3/10. Okay. When we divide, how do you think of division? If I say 40 divided by 4, how do you make sense of that in your head? What is taking 40 and dividing it by 4, what does it mean? Hasn't answered yet. Johnny.
You have like 40 berries or whatever.
40 berries.
Put them up into 4 different.
put it into four different baskets.
And then you see how many you have in the basket,
It's the quotient. Okay, so you take 40 berries, okay? 40 berries, and you put them into four baskets, okay? And then you look at each basket, how many are each basket, right? Can we also do this? Can we take the 40 things and put them in groups of four?
Mm-hmm.
And then what do we count? How many groups do we have? Okay? So I usually think of, like you said, John, 40 things divided into four groups, how many in each group? We can do the other way, and we're going to, this picture is going to help us see that, okay? We're going to see this picture, just briefly, talk about how this picture shows us that we can simplify this fraction. Okay? You ready for that? Okay. So I'm going to take each group of four that I can find, okay, and just erase the lines so that they become one big group. Okay? So if these have a common factor, a factor in common, the numerator and denominator, then we should, inside of this box and the whole square altogether, we should be able to, in both groups, divide everything into little chunks of four. If we can do that, well, that's like a picture of them having a common factor. Right. So I'll group these four, and group these four, and this is three here. So group these four all along here. Okay, still a group of four. We will group these four, and look at that, there's nothing left over. I can perfectly group them all into four. I can not only do it in the whole square, but I can do that within this small part of the square, the part of the square that is the product of these two fractions. Okay. Now, let's see what we have. How many pieces do we have inside this rectangle now that we've grouped four together into one each? John?
Three.
You got three. You got one, two, and three of those.
Three.
Well, what are they? Three of what kinds of things? How many of those are in the whole? The whole thing, right?
Well, seven? I don't know.
Well, let's see. We got a group of four, right? Making one new thing. In a different kind of thing. Two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. Oh, I missed this one right here. Ten. Did you see what I did there? I forgot that one right below because it was in my little circle, but it was actually outside of this little rectangle. So I'll count them again real quick. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine, and ten. Right? So three of these things we have, and ten of them together will make the whole thing, huh?
Oh, yeah.
So, yes, when we multiply fractions, say I want to multiply 3/8 by 4/5, I multiply straight across, but now I can see why. Because this new little rectangle is just part of the 1 by 1 square. Well, there's three pieces here, there's four pieces here, so I'll have a total of 12 pieces, you know, like in my possession. What will these pieces be? Well, there's 8 that make up this whole thing and 5 that make up this whole thing. I can see from the picture that to make the new square, the 1 by 1 square, I would need to use 40 of these pieces. And then we can simplify that. Divide by 4, divide by 4, and we get 3/10. What am I trying to show you here? Feel like you understand that a little bit more than before? Okay. How many of you, like me, in 8th grade, would say that you did not before now know why you multiply fractions straight across? That was me in 8th grade. Okay? No idea. Magic trick. Wonderful, wonderful magic trick. Convenient, easy thing to do, multiply straight across. Okay. The day that I learned fraction multiplication, so relieved because I had learned fraction and addition before that, and it was such a hassle. Like finding common denominators and, you know, least common, it was just a real bummer. And then this, you just multiply straight across. How easy is that? Okay? So, it's just real quick, multiplying a couple of fractions together. Alright? About 3/4 times 5/8. Okay, gonna multiply this together. Just really quickly, show me why we multiply them that way in the same way that we just did, okay? So then if your parents ever asked you, hey, why do you multiply fractions the way you do, you can wow them with some kind of an explanation of why that is, right? Just work out that why we multiply these straight across. So, I think everybody drew the whole grid, okay? But once we know we are looking to find, we don't really have to draw the whole grid, right? We just need to know what we're looking for. We're looking for the 3/5 times the, or sorry, the 3/4 times the 5/8. We're looking to see how many do we have and how many make the whole, okay? That's what we need to know. So how many pieces do we have? Like, how many things do we have? Alex? Maybe I need to ask a question a little better. Like, not how many make up the whole thing, but how many of those pieces do we have?
Oh, 15.
15. But you can see inside this rectangle will clearly be like a number of little rectangles, and that's how many of those things that we have. We have 15 of them. How many of those things make up the whole thing, Charlie?
32.
There are, this one is cut into 4 pieces, this one's cut into 8 pieces, so we look at the product, we have 32 that make up the whole area, okay? So this area of this thing is one square, okay? This is 15/32 of one square, okay? There are 32 pieces that make up the whole square, there's 15 that we have, 15/32. Simplify that. Not 15/32, that's what it is. Let's go to this next here. What I'd like you to do real quick. See how fresh this is in your memory. Alright. I don't think I saw this, just in case. It's not a really uncommon mistake. Call this, what do you think the mistake is in logic? Alex?
Improper fraction.
No, improper is not wrong, it's not incorrect. If someone were to add these two and get an incorrect answer, what do you think a very common incorrect answer is, Jacob?
Just straight across.
Right, and so the fraction at the end would be what? What answer would I get? Really common thing to say is the sum of these two fractions, okay? That's not true, but why? And how you put your hand down if you're just gonna say because we need a common denominator. Okay. If you can explain more why we need a common denominator, what even really means, Josie?
Well, the only thing that I got would be like, it's trying to put a square object in.
There's just not, there's a lack of compatibility there.
Yes.
You can't make those two things go together. Okay? Any other thoughts?
So, the pieces, like if you were, like, the pieces are different sizes.
Okay. now we're identifying that when we say 5/6 and 1/4, we're saying there's five of something. It's like the six is describing the thing that you have five of. We talked about this already. Four is saying you, it's describing the thing you have one of. And saying 5/6 + 1/4 = 6/10 makes no more sense than saying that 5 apples + 1 orange = 6 apple oranges. Just make up some new thing, right? Are they apple oranges? No, they don't. They don't morph together just because they're in the same space. Okay, and neither do these. Right? To get these to add together, somehow I'd have to make apples and oranges the same thing, which they can't be. There's not. Well, as far as I know, there's not such thing as an apple orange. Okay. So let's get rid of that. Let's talk about. Why 5/6 + 1/4 = 6/10. Okay? And he goes back to what Cadence just said. 5/6, well, what is that? That's five of a thing that six makes the whole, right? So there are some six. We have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of them. Right? And 1/4, so that's a different kind of a thing. These are fourths, I have one of them. And to say 5 of them + 1 of them = 6 of them is like saying 6 apple oranges. They don't go together, they don't morph, okay? But can we do something with these pieces? Right? All we've done is just taken the whole thing and just cut it into pieces. Can we do something with each of these pieces to make them the same kind of piece? Yeah? And then more pieces. Right? Very, very good. So these six pieces and these four pieces, I can cut them differently, so that I wind up with the same amount of pieces. Right? How many pieces could I wind up with the same amount in both? Yeah, 12. Right? Could do 24. 24 is a common thing to get, right? 6 × 4 = 24. But it could be easier. 24 is not wrong. It's just more work. 12. We could just cut each of these into how many pieces? Each of these six. Cut them into two pieces each. So for those of you who know how to find common denominators, when you multiply this by 2, that's what you're doing. You're taking the number of pieces that make a whole, you're doubling it. Okay? And look, at the same time, when you double all of the whole thing, every piece, so that you have 12 pieces total, you also doubled the pieces that we have, right? The 5 pieces that you have also, the number of those got doubled. Okay? That's why we multiply the denominator and the numerator at the same time, not just one or the other, but both. Okay, and here, how many can we divide each of these pieces into and also end up with 12 pieces? 3. We're going to cut all of these pieces into 3 pieces each. 4 pieces times 3 pieces each is 12 pieces total. Right? And look at that. At the same time that we divided all those pieces into 3 pieces each, we divided the one that we have into 3 pieces as well. Right? So, divide each piece into 6, or sorry, into 2 pieces. We have twice as many that make up the whole. And clearly, we also have twice as many in our possession. We have twice as many number of pieces. Okay. Here, let's take each piece and cut it into 3, so we have a total of 12 that make up the whole. That one piece that we had, also, the number of it, not the size, right? The size is going to get smaller. But we have 3 of them now. Okay. We had 1 to start with. It got cut into 3 pieces, and so we have 3. 10 of these 12ths plus 3 of these 12ths, because I had 5 before, each cutting into 2 makes them into 12ths. Cutting this one into 3 pieces makes them into 12ths. You have 10 of them plus 3 of them. You get 13 of those 12ths. Okay? Now, should we turn into 1 and 1 12th, or should we not turn it into 1 and 1 12th? Should, okay? And then you shouldn't. Is there a right or a wrong here?
No.
Is this any? I mean, is what's right about this answer? Okay.
It's
that was right about it. What's correct about it? Why is it correct? more correct than this is. So what is the correctness of both of these answers, Sean?
Well, I guess if you wanted a whole for, or like a whole number to make it easier to maneuver or use.
Okay.
Instead of if you have more to the problem than just finding the answer to that. It's kind of easier for me at least to.
All right, that's easier.
Yeah.
But is it more correct?
What?
What's correct about it? Sean?
It's just, it's overflowing, so it creates a whole number. And it's just a different way of showing it.
Right. But the correct thing about this answer and about this is they're both correct, is that they correctly tell you how many pieces and what size they are. That's what's correct about it. Now the interesting thing is, while this, I think, is a good final answer, because if I'm talking about like gallons of milk, I want to know that there's 1 1/12 gallons of milk. If you tell me there's 13/12, I almost just do this in my head, like, well, how many gallons is that? One whole gallon, a little bit more, okay, 13/12, that's what that is. If I want to use it though, if I want to use a fraction and add it to another fraction, multiply it by another fraction, something like that, then, well, say I want to add 1 1/12 plus 5/6. What's the first thing I do with this fraction? Josie?
You turn it back into an improper fraction.
Again. Alright? So as a useful, I guess it depends on how we're trying to use it. If I try to use it to tell you how many gallons, that's pretty useful. If I try to multiply it by some other fraction, then that would be useful. Right? All that's to say, like, don't really care when on a test or whatever, if you say 13/12 or 1 1/12, okay? This is so ingrained in you, I'm not worried about it. If you say 13/12 or 1 1/12, they're both correct.
I'm not worried.
That's just my opinion on that. Either way, it's the exact same number. Okay. So we can't add fractions, as Caden said, because they're different size things. Unless they're the exact same size, we cannot put them together. You see a picture of why they put together. It doesn't make any sense. When we find a common denominator, it's not magic and it's not a mystery. All we're doing is making the pieces that make up the whole. What are we making them?
Equal.
Equal in a way. Like, what's equal about them?
They have the same amount of pieces.
Same, yeah. Both holes take the same amount of pieces to make them up. The pieces that they're cut into are the same size. The same thing. 12s and 12s, not 4s and 6. Let's now do one more thing with fractions. Okay. Notice I have here 2 days from now, area of fractions, order of operations test. Okay. If I have 3/4 divided by 5/8. That real quick and let's see where everybody is. Okay, just by walking around I can tell this is a little more rusty.
Yeah.
Okay? Huh? On average. It's a little more rusty than say the addition. People did generally on average just fine with the addition here. We know there's something about, some of us know there's something like multiplication. Can become multiplication? Do we remember that correctly? Okay, some of you put 5/8 divided by 3/4, that's backwards. It does make a difference, right? With division, that makes a difference. 12 divided by 3 is different from 3 divided by 12. Multiplication is different. 3 times 4, 4 times 3, it doesn't make a difference, but in division, it makes a difference, okay? So, let's just throw it out there. I'm still kind of vague. I haven't really said what you're supposed to do when you divide fractions. I want you to say what you did. And say why you did it, then go right ahead. Josie?
I multiplied 3/4 times 8 over 5, because that's what was kind of drilled into our brain. I don't know exactly what we're supposed to do that.
I don't know why.
I don't remember why exactly, but then you just go down the chain like you would before, and then you finally end up at 1 1/5.
Okay, so and we've multiplied, right? We talked about that, multiplied straight across, multiplied 10, so on and so on. Okay, something differently, Johnny.
I got the, I did the same 3/4 times, I mean 3/4 divided by 8/5, and then I cross divided 8/4 to make it 3/2 and 4/5, and then.
Cross divided. Okay, so you made it.
I got
3/2
divided
by.
8/5. I mean, 4/5.
4/5, okay.
And then I multiplied straight across, and then.
So it says divide, but you just multiply straight across?
Well, I meant to do 3/2 times, and then I got 12/10 and one, and then 1/5.
Alright, so instead of saying divide, you meant to say multiply.
Yeah.
Is that what you're saying?
Well, I meant to do multiply on the other
one. So divide here, but multiply there?
Yeah.
Oh. So
well, have that, because I just rewrote it, and then I put the restricted colon for the 5/8.
Okay.
And then I just put the, then I multiply the 3/2.
No, I have multiplied.
Okay. Sounds a little bit kind of all over the place. First dividing, then dividing just kind of changes into multiplication. Dividing and multiplication can't be the same thing. Like sometimes we'll get the same answer just by coincidence, but they can't be the same operation, right? Okay, so there's that. There's definitely like some commonality here. Right? Are we remembering this right or not, Cadence? Okay, so instead of going 3/2 and 4/5, you go 3/1 and 2/5. Okay. I think we're still a little bit. There's something about multiplication, there's something about reciprocals. It's like in our heads, are we remembering it right or are we not? Right? Sean?
I remember reciprocal, you have to like flip the second one, you had to flip the denominator to the top. I don't know why,
okay. A common thing.
Yeah.
Okay, to not know why we're doing that. That's why we're, you know, in a more advanced class, we can look at why these things are true. Now, are you sure it's 3/4 times 8/5? Is it maybe 4/3 times 5/8? Take the reciprocal of the numerator instead?
Are you?
See that a lot. Let's clear it up. Okay? Using some things that we now get. Okay, so now we're crossing over from, I can see why fraction multiplication works. Okay? I know that it works. I know that multiplying straight across, I can justify that, okay? I'm not gonna show you a picture of that here because you know how fraction multiplication works. So now I'm gonna use fraction multiplication, something we already have in our toolbox. I'm going to take this 3/4 over 5/8. Now, can I multiply this fraction by some other fraction? This is a fraction that has fractions within the fraction, right? Can I multiply it by something?
Yes.
Right, sure. But I can't change what it's worth, right? I can't just multiply this by 1/4 for no reason. It's got to stay the same, right? What can I multiply that keeps things the same? Multiply it by something and nothing changes. What's the one number that I can multiply by?
One.
I can multiply by one. So I can multiply this by one. Right?
Yeah.
Okay? Mm-hmm. Now, what kind of fractions are equal to one? Can you give me a fraction that's equal to one?
12/12.
A number divided by itself, right? 12 things divided into 12 groups, one in each group, 12 things divided into groups of 12. There's one group of 12, okay? So I'm going to multiply this by a fraction that is a number divided by itself. That number that's going to be divided by itself is 8/5. 8/5/8. But multiplying by 8/5/8 is just 1. Multiplying by 1, I have not changed what this number is. It's the same as it ever was. It might look a little different. Now, in the denominator, we do matrix multiplication. Or not matrix, we do fraction multiplication. Okay? Let's just say we multiply straight across. 8 times 5, 5 times 8, whatever. 40. 8 times 5 down here, 40. Now it's 40 over 40. 1. So this is just 1. What do you get when you divide a number by 1?
Itself.
12 divided by 1, 12. 17 divided by 1, 12. Or 17. 25 divided by 1, 25. And so on. Okay? So whatever I get here, it'll be like divided by 1. So that'll be the answer. Right? Just divided by 1. So whatever I get here is the answer. Well, that the up here is 3 fourths times 8 fifths. 3 fourths times 8 fifths. 3 fourths times the reciprocal of 5 eighths. Yes? So it would be, what Josie gave us here, 6 fifths.
I got 12 over 10.
Yeah, 6
fifths. So then we can 12 and 10 both divided by 5.
And you get 1
fifth. 6 fifths, 1 and 1 fifth. Okay. So here we have 3 fourths times 8 fifths, which I'm going to do. What I'm trying to show you here is, yes, you do multiply by the reciprocal of the denominator, but why? Well, at least I can prove it must be true, because we know about matrix multiplication, we know about a number divided by itself, we know about a number divided by 1. So all I do is I take the original fraction or the original division problem and multiply the numerator and denominator by the same thing. So I'm just multiplying the 1 here. Okay? In the denominator I get a 1, and in the numerator I find 3 fourths times 8 fifths, the numerator multiplied by the reciprocal of the denominator. And that's it. Let's have a good day.